Hello everyone, this is Erlin from the Experience Research Lab. Today I'll show you how to read and interpret the output of discriminant analysis in SPSS, which is really important to draw reliable conclusions and deliver actionable insights to clients internally or externally. A discriminant analysis builds a predictive model for mutually exclusive and collectively exhaustive group membership by measuring the relationship of a dependent categorical variable with one or more independent scale predictors. Discriminant analysis is applicable across sectors and industries. In companies providing telecommunications services, for example, it can help develop personalized offers to prospective customers. Meanwhile, in the banking and financial industry, discriminant analysis can help identify the people who have low and high credit risk. The output discussed in this video is obtained from the discriminant analysis I did in the previous video that you can check later or anytime you're available. The dataset has 5 variables. Outdoor, social, and conservative are the independent predictors, while the job is the dependent grouping variable. The dependent variable has 3 values, 1 for customer service, 2 for mechanics, and 3 for dispatch. So my objective here is to predict group membership by measuring the relationship between the job and the characters of people. What job is most suitable for outdoor people? Is it the customer service, mechanic, or dispatch? How about the social and the conservative? To achieve my objective, I need to run a discriminant analysis. However, since the analysis only works with normally distributed data, I need to run a descriptive analysis on the data frequencies of the 3 predictors and check the normality of the data distribution. As shown here, there are 244 valid cases and no missing value. The standard error of means for the 3 variables are pretty similar. The lowest is 0.238 and the highest is 0.351. The skewness of the 3 predictors is close to 0, which indicates normally distributed data. With negative skewness of minus 0.418, the outdoor is indeed rather left skewed. It has a tail towards the left and a peak towards the right. However, it is still considered normally distributed data. The kurtosis varies across variables. The lowest is minus 0.659 and the highest is 0.281. Within this range, all predictors are good to go with discriminant analysis. But before I continue, let us pause for a while. Here I have put the statistics and histograms of all predictors to see and compare the data distributions. In the previous video, I did discriminant analysis by clicking Analyze, Classify, and Discriminant. This is the discriminant analysis dialog box. As mentioned early on, the grouping variable is the job, while the independents are outdoor, social, and conservative. On the statistics window, I tick means, univariate ANOVAs, boxes M, within group correlation matrix, fissures, and unstandardized co-function coefficient. On the classification window, I tick compute size, within groups covariance matrix, summary table, and leave one out classification. Meanwhile, on the save window, I tick the first and last options. So without bootstrapping, this is how the output of discriminant analysis looks. As you can see on the left pane, SPSS has created several tables that I will explain one by one. The first table is Analysis Case Processing Summary. It basically summarizes the number of cases analyzed and excluded in the analysis. As mentioned earlier on, there are 244 valid cases, and none of them is excluded for any of the reasons highlighted here. The second table, Group Statistics, presents the number of valid cases, the mean and the standard deviations for each predictor in different groups. There seems to be an association between means and standard deviations except for social. As highlighted here, the means for customer service is considerably higher, but the standard deviation is not. Regarding the group size, the mechanic is the largest with 93 cases, while the dispatch is the smallest with only 66 cases. The third table, Test of Equality of Group Means, measures each independent variable's potential before creating the model. Looking at this table, I can say that the 3 variables are good discriminators. The significance value, which is lower than 0.001, confirms this. Social is the best discriminator, followed by the outdoor and conservative. The fourth table, pool within group matrices, shows the strongest correlation is between social and outdoor, but it is only 0.071, not strong enough to be of a concern. The fifth table, log determinants, measures the variability of the groups. There are 2 indicators here, the log determinants and the differences among groups. It turns out that the customer service is the most variable with the highest log determinant of 8.162. It is most different from the mechanic whose log determinant is 7.865. So if you calculate it, the maximum difference is 2.98, which is not large enough to say that they have different covariance matrices. Boxes M test the assumption of the equality of covariances across groups. The sixth table, eigenvalues, provides information about the relative efficacy of each discriminant function. Here, SPSS used the first two canonical discriminant function. The seventh table, weak lambda, measures how well each function separates cases into groups. The lower the value, the better the discriminatory ability. In this case, using two canonical discriminant function is proven better than using only the second, as it halves weak lambda from 0.757 to 0.364. The associated chi-square statistic tests the hypothesis that the means of the function listed are equal across groups. The small significance value indicates that the discriminant function is better at separating the groups. The 8th table, standardized canonical discriminant function coefficients, allows me to compare the three predictor variables. The higher the coefficients, the better the discriminatory ability. In the first canonical discriminant function, social shows the best discriminatory ability. However, in the second function, outdoor is the best. Further, I can use this table to calculate the discriminant score for a given case. Since SPSS uses two functions, there are two formulas to calculate the discriminant score. The first formula is that score equals 0.379 multiplied by Z outdoor minus 0.831 multiplied by Z social plus 0.517 multiplied by Z conservative. Meanwhile, the second formula is that score equals 0.926 multiplied by Z outdoor plus 0.213 multiplied by Z social minus 0.291 multiplied by Z conservative. By the way, Z outdoor, Z social, and Z conservative are the standardized coefficients for the three predictor variables. In the analysis, I intentionally didn't save it because the three predictors use the same scale measure. Therefore, instead of the standardized coefficient, I can use the value of each variable to get an insight into how the discriminant score using the two functions differ. So if I take case number one, for example, the first discriminant score equals 0.379 multiplied by 10 minus 0.831 multiplied by 22 plus 0.517 multiplied by 5 equals minus 11.907. While the second score equals 0.926 multiplied by 10 plus 0.213 multiplied by 22 minus 0.291 multiplied by 5 equals 12.491. The mean table structure matrix shows the correlations of each predictor variable with the discriminant function. Social strongly impacts the discriminant score calculated using the first function. Meanwhile, outdoor remains the strongest on the second function. The 10th table, canonical discriminant function coefficient, is the unstandardized version. Here, the formulas to calculate the discriminant score come with constant values, 0.937 for the first function and minus 3.623 for the second one. So using the unstandardized coefficients, the first discriminant score equals 0.092 multiplied by Z outdoor minus 0.194 multiplied by Z social plus 0.155 multiplied by Z conservative plus 0.937. This is the constant value. And the second discriminant score equals 0.225 multiplied by Z outdoor plus 0.050 multiplied by Z social minus 0.087 multiplied by Z conservative minus 3.623. And if I take the same example, the first discriminant score equals 0.092 multiplied by 10 minus 0.194 multiplied by 22 plus 0.155 multiplied by 5 plus 0.937 equals minus 1.636. And the second discriminant score equals 0.225 multiplied by 10 plus 0.050 multiplied by 22 minus 0.087 multiplied by 5 minus 3.623 equals minus 0.7 0.08. Despite the differences in the coefficient functions, the ordering in both standardized and unstandardized version is consistent. Social comes first in the first function and outdoor in the second. Let us continue to the 11th table, functions at group centroids. This table shows how the grouping variables differ in the first and second discriminant function. The logic is pretty simple. First, use the unstandardized canonical discriminant functions to calculate the discriminant score for each case. Second, group cases by jobs. And third, compute the means per group. So if I use the first function to calculate the discriminant score for each case in my dataset, I will find that the mean of the scores for customer service group is -1.219. Likewise, if I use the second function, I will find that the mean of the scores by the mechanic group is 0.715. The 12th table is the classification processing summary. It says that the 244 cases are successfully classified. Now they are all members of a group. In other words, they are collectively exhaustive. The 13th table, prior probabilities for groups, shows the distributions of observations into the job groups used as the starting point of the analysis. A priori, 38.1% of the cases fall to the mechanic jobs, while the other 34.8% fall to the customer service. Therefore, this model will adjust the classification functions to the group sizes. The 14th table, classification functions coefficients, shows different classification functions used to assign cases to job groups. Like the unstandardized canonical discriminant function coefficients, the formulas to calculate the classification scores come with constant values. -23.098 for the customer service, -25.206 for the mechanic, and -20.771 for the dispatch. Therefore, the final formulas for the customer service equals 0.626 multiplied by Z outdoor plus 1.241 multiplied by Z social plus 0.686 multiplied by Z conservative -23.098. For the mechanic, it equals 0.997 multiplied by Z outdoor plus 1.038 multiplied by Z social plus 0.796 multiplied by Z conservative -25.206. And the dispatch equals 0.843 multiplied by Z outdoor plus 0.722 multiplied by Z social plus 1.106 multiplied by Z conservative -20.771. This is the constant value. Again, taking the same example, classification scores for case number 1 for the customer service equals 13.894, for the mechanic equals 11.58, and for the dispatch equals 9.073. Using this classification function, the discriminant model assigns the case to the group with the highest classification score. Therefore, looking at the example, I can tell that the model will classify case number 1 to the customer service group. Now let us take another example with case number 2. The classification score for customer service equals 10.879, mechanic equals 11.58, and dispatch equals 9.941. Since the classification score is highest in the mechanic group, I can tell that the model will assign case number 2 to the mechanic group. Another way to see it is by simply referring to the coefficients in the table. Here, outdoor scores the highest coefficients for the mechanic. It means that the outdoor people are more likely to do mechanic jobs. Applying the same logic, I can say that social people are more likely to do customer service jobs while the conservatives are more into dispatch job. Is it always correct? Apparently no. As shown in the 15th table, classification results, not all cases are classified correctly. Of the 244 cases used to create the model, only 68 of the 85 people who do customer service jobs are classified correctly. Overall, only 75.8% of the original group cases are classified correctly. To see where the model classifies cases correctly and incorrectly, I can go back to data editor. Here I have 4 new variables. This underscore 1 is the predicted group membership. The other 3 variables are the probability for each group membership, customer service, mechanic, and dispatch. Here, predicted group is based on the highest probability. For case number 1, the highest probability is 0.90376. Therefore, the predicted group membership is customer service, which is correct. Meanwhile, for case number 2, the highest probability is 0.48898. Therefore, the predicted group membership is mechanic, which is incorrect. If I went through all cases one by one up to case number 244, I would find 185 cases classified correctly, while the other 59 are not. Since classification based upon the cases used to create the model is considered too optimistic, I have told SPSS to validate the model with U method. Classify each case while leaving it out from the model calculations. It turns out that the result is not much different. Out of 68 people previously classified correctly to customer service jobs, 67 remain in the group. So that is how you read the output of discriminant analysis in SPSS. Remember, this analysis is only suitable to measure the relationship of a categorical dependent variable and independent scale predictor. If your dependent variable uses scales, you better consider linear regression that I will discuss later in the upcoming video. Today, I'll wrap it here. If you have any questions, please feel free to leave a comment. For more insights into data, including data collection, data entry, data transformations, and data analysis, especially in SPSS, please subscribe, listen, and watch our content that is available in text, audio, and video format. Thank you for being with me today. I'll see you next time in the other videos. Cheers!